And one thing I was reflecting on is I have a really hard time disciplining myself. And I have a plethora of dance classes available right now. I so don't want to even open one or buy a class, or I never felt, even now, like it didn't change. I don't feel motivated watching videos or online videos. I do feel motivated if the class is like, for example, a private or like a drop-in, or like you see the people working and you kind of doing the class with them. That's a little more motivating. But I was wondering how much can that model of virtual classes sustain itself, or is it even desirable to go that route for a client and for a school?
I think it's very, it depends, in the sense that I think that for a lot of people, especially when all of this will be over, they're going to love coming into a space where they can concentrate on themselves and have nothing around them that could distract them. Mm-hmm. And having that kind of attention from a teacher who will really take the time. On the other hand, there are certain teachers that you would want to, you know, train from that you might not be able to, like if a class is in New York or in California, and it's kind of nice to have the possibility of still joining a class with that specific person you really want to do class with, but you can't necessarily be able to be there. Mm-hmm. So I think it's really, it depends on what you're looking for. But I know that, like, for me as a teacher, it really is hard. I'm really the hands-on, let me give you corrections, let me make sure that you understand where we're going, because I want to really see you improve and get stronger. So it's really hard to give a class online because there's only so much you can correct.
What are the limitations?
Well, I mean, for example, you know, if I'm working a specific stretch and I'm seeing that the person's hip's not in the right place, right? I can physically show it to them by doing it for them. But at the same time, sometimes you just need that person who will take the hip and just rotate it a certain way and say, this is the sensation you're looking for. Mm-hmm. And that's something you can't do over the net. You can explain it as much as you can, but sometimes you just need that clear explanation. And also on a one-to-one basis in my classes, I really like taking my students where they are. So each person is not working on the same thing, and they might not be at the same level necessarily, but there's something specific I'll be working for them that I know will help them get farther. Mm-hmm. When you're giving a class online, well, you kind of have to be as general as possible so that everybody gets what they can out of that class. It's more impersonal. As much as you want to be there, it's, you know, there's that distance is created just because there's a screen.
Do you do those classes? Do you give them?
I've given a few. It's not something I'm very comfortable with yet, because I don't feel I've found necessarily the right way of doing it, or the students seem to really enjoy it because they want to take class and they want to have specific technical classes with me. So that's great. And right now with COVID, I find it's really important that when people are asking you for things that you can supply, like when I give classes to, you know, some of my students, or if I have a school that I've been a regular teacher at and they ask me for a class, I don't charge, just because everybody's suffering right now. And, you know, if all I have to do is give you a class for an hour and a half, I'm more than happy to do it. And especially when you have students who really want to learn and they have the time, I'll do it. But it's not an easy thing. You really need to organize properly. You need to be really clear in what you're explaining. And the other thing you always have to keep an eye out for, and it's really difficult, is, you know, how stable is my internet?
Yeah, it's
how stable are my students' internet? Because sometimes I'll be giving a correction and then all of a sudden the student's frozen. And I'm like, I don't know if they heard me. I don't know if they got the correction. And then you just keep on going because there's other people waiting, you know?
Yeah. And also it's a tough sell, like, because you have to make sure that on your on your end, the technical aspect is covered. Like, are you plugged in? Are you Wi-Fi? Is your Wi-Fi a recent Wi-Fi, or you have that five-year-old router? So you don't know where the bottleneck is, but you're the one selling the service. So it's, I thought about it. I was like, man, if I'm giving a class and it's frozen, do I charge people? Like, is it their fault, my fault? No way to figure it out.
Yeah.
So it's a difficult, like, I thought about it a long time. That's why I wanted to ask you. I have not even started to give any Zoom classes. I don't even know if I will. I have no idea. I'm working on another project. I want to build some kind of a online offering of a school, like something that complements what I already do live. So whenever I go back, I can say, well, if you want to review, go on. You know, we have an online curriculum also. It definitely pushes a lot of people, and Quebec especially, I think, is a bit late to the game, like virtual wise. So I guess that's the positive side. I guess it pushes that connection aspect, that virtual aspect that we never considered. And maybe that's going to be complementary after all this. I have no idea.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, I look at, you know, when I'm taking, for example, I do mostly yoga classes. I don't really go to the virtual online classes. I literally go for classes that were videotaped. Because it gives me
what do you do? Like, what's the class you take?
It depends. I specifically like Ashtanga.
Okay.
So that's the style of yoga I do.
But,
I like, you have many apps. Like, okay, I use four different ones.
Okay.
I use Yoga International, Groker. I also use Do You Yoga, and Down Dog. I use a lot of different ones because for different reasons. And I think that there is no right app. I think that you need to try a lot of different ones and you find the ones that work for you. Some of them are with subscriptions, so it's great to be able to, some of them do give you a free trial so you can try a few classes and you have time to stop the subscription if you decide that it's not the app for you. So I think you need to try different things, try different ones. But what I like is that I can actually go specifically for what I want. So if today I'm feeling like my back is tight, well, I'll go for a class that's specific to back openers and things of that nature. So it's mostly videos because an open virtual line is not exactly what you're saying. If the video freezes and I can't get back on, and then the class has kept on going forward and I've now catch up 10 minutes later, there's a lot of that class missing.
There's a lot of classes that I saw at the beginning because I wanted to know what the salsa world was doing. And I was looking at a lot of classes. And as much as the people were lovely and doing the right thing and trying to hustle, man, the quality, no. Like the video, the cell phone held by a bookcase that falls, the cell phone, the guy is like 2 kilometers away. Follow my footwork. I'm like, what are you doing? Like, there's so many considerations. Like, and you're doing this, yeah, for free, granted. But I was looking at all of this. I said, okay, right now we're in a very hype period. Like, everybody's trying different avenues.
Right now, everyone and their sisters, a dance teacher, yoga teacher, everybody. And a lot of students who've asked me, are you giving like online class? I'm like, nope.
No,
I said, there's a lot out there. Yeah. Look for what works for you. And the only classes I have been giving are for studios where I already teach. And the people coming online are my students.
Yeah.
People who already know me. So they know my vocabulary. They know how I work. So it's a lot easier for them to follow my class as
100%.
Well.
I think that there's something to be said. Something you can maybe grasp if you're already a seasoned dancer and you kind of can recognize what a class can give you and on a just drop-in basis. But if you're talking development, all these classes, there's not 95%, it's not pertinent because if you want to develop somebody, let's say, I'll just take my world, a salsa dancer. If you want to develop them, you need a program. You don't need just to give them classes here and there. You have to have a logic to say,
absolutely,
go from point A to point Z. You're not going to just say, okay, today is an intermediate class, but yeah, you're just helping a selected amount of few people that, and even then, what is intermediate? You can
one and two, they're usually going to learn a combo or a choreography, exactly. but that's not dance.
Exactly.
Right. It's a combo or choreography, and you can do that. Yep, if you want to learn how to dance, then you need the technical aspect, and then you have to learn, okay, well, 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 7, you know, you have to be really specific. And it's the same thing in every other style of dance. So that's why by teaching my students who've been with me, who've taken class, when I start up at a certain place, they know where we're going and they know, you know, what I'm looking for and what the intent is. And that's not so easy to do online, especially if you don't know who's taking your class.
Exactly.
And, you know, there's an aspect that's very interesting to me that like the studio, some of the studios I work for who've asked for classes and stuff, like they're like, they tell their students, you do realize that you are not insured at home. So if there's something you want to do, think about it.
Yeah.
And as a teacher, I think that's also our responsibility. How much do you let them do because they are not in an environment where you can protect them, help them, stop them if it's too much?
No, you just say, I wasn't there. I was virtual. I was a robot. It wasn't me. But you touched a point also, and it's, I just got a flash. I was thinking it's also managing expectation to be able to give proper customer service. Like, for example, when people would come in from other schools or from the street and they say, I'm an advanced dancer or anything along the line, like I do shows international. Yeah. Do you want to take classes from me? That's why you're international. So usually when people are going to take classes, I go, well, you just have to do a little eval and 5 minutes, I watch you dance and I'll tell you what level you are at our school. And I had developed a keen sense of words of what to say, not to destroy the person, you know?
It's like, yeah.
It's like, so the advanced dancer can do a proper crossbody lead. Uh-huh. Mm, yeah. So where did you go? Yeah. I learned international school. Yeah. But you can't dance. Now, this is where I come in and I tell them, well, listen, blah, blah, blah. We are a different style and a sweet coat, like it just kind of sweet talk the guy so he doesn't feel destroyed, right? So I do it every week for maybe 3-4 people a week. Okay. So and then that person that accepts their position in our school goes into the right level with a homogeneous kind of like everybody's the same level. And they evolve together, and we have 6 levels. So we manage the expectation of the people and of the group, so everybody's happy. So everybody feels it's not like a drop in every time somebody can come in and he doesn't know what level he is. He's maybe too slow or too experienced, and then he went, oh, it's trop facile. I want to stop this. Or, my God, I can't follow. If I told you you were intermediate, like I would challenge every time. I go, listen, trust me, if you're intermediate, one, it's the right place. Don't worry about it. I saw too many dancers to be wrong. I can be wrong 1% of the time. So if they trust me and then they can get proper customer service, you cannot do that online. Sadly.
You cannot. It's true.
I thought about it. So if I open an intermediate class and it's advanced dancers that think they're intermediate and then they start the class and they find it too easy, then they want their money back. Now, on the opposite, if it's a beginner thinks he's intermediate and he can't follow, well, it's too hard. He can complain, and rightly so. So how can I myself give the proper class besides saying, hey, come and take a class with the Ilias, you know, this fantastic class, and not say anything, class for all. And then people...
But I think that's why I like the principle of subscriptions on, like, in the yoga world. Because I'm going to subscribe to this this channel, right? And they will have thousands of videos, different teachers, different levels. And it gives me the option to try different things. But at the same time, the subscription you're paying is minimal compared to what it would be if you were giving a class.
Got it.
Or if you were taking a class. So it's a whole other way of functioning. And I don't know if Dance World can do it in that way, just because whatever style of yoga you take, right, it has a very clear line of movement. Ashtanga has these series. Hatha has these series. Kundalini is done like this. And that's the style you're taking. These are the poses you're going to see. So everybody knows what to expect.
Mm-hmm.
how do you do that in a dance class? Like, you know what I mean? Even in salsa, even though you have a lot of steps that we recognize, there are so many different ways of adding style and giving it your flair. And how do you teach that? You know, even in technical classes, there's so many different options of, if I give a class of jumps and turns, do you know how many jumps and turns there are? How am I going to fit a jump in a room that's, you know, 8x8? There's so many things to take into consideration because there's so much movement. There's so much traveling involved. So unless you have your own studio and your students have their own studio, there's only so much you can give.